Hello, everyone. Thank you very much for joining us today at Pop Madness. We are completely virtual this year, as you know, with everything that's been going on. So thank you very much for joining us in our new format. And thank you for coming today to our Fan Fiction 101 panel. I would like to introduce you to our presenters. We have Elsinore and Paula.
Hello.
And they are fan fiction experts and with the archive of our own. So they're going to talk to you a little bit today about fan fiction, what fan fiction is. And at the end, we will be taking some questions. If you have any questions, please just put them in our chat room and we will ask those at the end. We'll get to as many as we can. And just in case we have any technical difficulties, I just want to state for the record, I am not a cat. So I'm going to pass it over to you ladies, and thank you very much for being here, and here you go.
Okay. Hi, everybody.
Yes, please. I have questions because we would love to answer them.
Yes.
We're not scary, we promise.
So Elsinore and I actually met through working with the Organization of Transformative Works, which is the organization that works with AO3, that owns AO3, as it were. I can't talk today, Elsinore.
We do that. We have brain fail all the time. And the OTW does fan lore, which is this really cool kind of repository of fan knowledge and history, where you can look up tropes, you can look up the history, you can look up pretty much anything and see where that came from. And there's all these really interesting in-depth articles. There's this Open Doors, which goes through all of these old archives that were one-off archives that have, you know, not been in use anymore and are in danger of, you know, disappearing, and imports them into AO3 to save them, and all these other projects. So, you know, OTW does a lot of cool stuff, and we're happy to be a part of it.
Yes. So should we get started on...
Yes, load up the PowerPoint.
Okay, load up the PowerPoint. Yay! All right. So,
we're not talking
this isn't like a school PowerPoint or something. It's, you know,
nerdy, I promise.
It's yes. All right. Can everybody see that? Are we good? Hey, okay.
Beautiful.
So, Fanfiction 101, an introduction to fanfiction, fandom, the community of online spaces, how to find fun stuff, terminology, all while dragging your friends and kicking and screaming. Fanfiction 101.
As you can see, we are very serious people.
Yes. So what is transformative? People transform media to get something out of it in a way that they originally could not. And this is actually a urge that humanity has had since the beginning. If you truly think about it, humanity has been telling and retelling its stories since the get-go. You can look to some of our sacred texts. You could look to like the Odyssey, which has been transformed in multiple ways. Anything else you could think of, Elle?
I mean, one of my favorite movies of all time is 10 Things I Hate About You. And 10 Things I Hate About You is a retelling of Taming of the Shrew. And then you have, you know, Disney's animated The Lion King, which is Hamlet, which, if you can tell by my username right here, is, you know, one of my favorite plays, because my username is Castle Elsinore, which may or may not be a Shakespeare joke. And so people will retell the same stories and put their own spin on it. And that's literally what fandom does. That's our shtick. And so for this, we have, you know, our fandom mashups. We have I was at Star Wars Celebration, and there was this amazing Mandalorian Mulan cosplayer who put together this spectacular outfit. And it was a mashup of the two fandoms. Absolutely her own spin, perfectly transformative, freaking amazing. But cosplay in general is perfectly transformative because you're building it and you're making it and you're making your own stuff. So we have Rogue. We have here, we have, you know, female Tony Stark. I couldn't find the photo, but my favorite mashup cosplay of all time is Mortal Kombat's Sub-Zero and Elsa from Frozen. Brilliant. Would never have thought of it, but mashups are the greatest thing on the planet and perfectly transformative.
Yeah, and it also tends to be like people of color, women tend to find themselves attracted to transformative works because, I mean, it still is, but it was a lot worse a couple decades ago. It was all males, all white males all the time in our media. So of course, people of color, women are attracted to fandom in a way that allows you to put yourself in it. So thus the female Tony Stark, the African-American Rogue. It allows you.
NBC's Hannibal, one of the really cool things that they did was they gender swapped three of the main characters that were men in the original book and made them women in the show.
Let's see what else. It's also, this could be considered fandom.
Mashups and memes. If you're taking something and putting your own spin on it, congratulations, it's transformative. You have made fan art. And yes, you can catch Bernie Sanders with an Ultra Ball.
Or have a Darkwing Goose.
The terrible goose.
That might be...
who is very difficult to smuggle a mug out of a bar.
Yeah, if we've got any youngins, it might be they might miss the Darkwing Duck thing, but that's Darkwing Duck and a terrible
goose. They redid Darkwing Duck.
Did they? Oh, okay. I didn't know that.
Disney Plus.
Yeah. So this is more cosplay. Elsinore was actually, this is another one from Star Wars, your Star Wars convention that you were at. Which one was that?
This was also at Celebration Chicago. The original's available on Disney Plus as well. Yes. So a bunch of Trekkies who are also Star Wars nerds, but they came as Trekkies that day, and showed up to, you can see the photo, to Star Wars Celebration. And it's just an expression of fandom at its greatest, where they're coming out and having fun and making it their own experience. And that's really what fandom is about. Yes, live long and prosper. Is making something your own.
Yeah, so there's mashups, there's telling your own version, there's what ifs. We're getting there. This is another way, this is more fan art, which even has kind of a meta thing, which is what we call when it's like working on several levels.
Meta is fourth wall humor, like Muppet humor. I love Muppet humor. So obviously movies are postponed because of the pandemic. So they're referencing real world events in fandom, hence fourth wall / meta.
Yeah.
If we want to get to the
next one, right. So again, fan fiction transformative works have been around a long time. These work could all be considered transformative. Again, 10 Things I Hate About You, we mentioned that was Shakespeare. Clueless is another retelling of a Shakespeare play, Emma. The League of Extraordinary Gentlemen, which was originally a comic and then became a marginal movie with Sean Connery in it, is taking all
of these... Well, even before that, it's based on the original Victorian Penny Dreadfuls.
Yes.
Then you have, of course, the Stars Showtime show, Penny Dreadful, which was based on the same thing, and which was excellent, except for the last episode.
Yes. And they took all of these characters, Mina Harker from the original Bram Stoker Dracula, Nemo, the Invisible Man, all people from Victorian novels and horror novels, and put them and mashed them together. That could be considered a fan fiction or a fan work, in the way that we're defining it as a transformative work. They just used
And stuff fan that was bids in the public are a real domain. Thing.
Fan bids are a real thing. And then Oh Brother, We're Out Thou is another one. I don't know if we've got any people old enough to remember that movie, but
it's a retelling of the Odyssey.
It's a retelling of the Odyssey in, let's see, the 1920s Depression era South. And it's hysterical and I love it. Anyway. Fanfic. It's a mostly written transformative approach to fandom that, if you haven't guessed, is about writing stories. What does that mean for you? Dream it, write it. You can find anything if it exists. There's probably fanfic of it. And if there's not fanfic of it, you should go on ahead and write it. That's actually kind of one of the fanfic jokes, is that if you can't find what you want, well, maybe you need to write it.
And the other thing is, even if it does exist, if you, it's called the two cakes theory.
I forgot to find something. It was that meme.
Basically, if you go, oh, I really want to write this. This sounds really cool. Oh, but somebody else already wrote it. You want to know what? There's nothing wrong about extra cake.
Or a different flavor cake.
Or a different flavor of cake. You want to know what? There's more chocolate cake. There's extra cake. You get to write your own version of the thing. If you want to do a slightly different spin or use slightly different language, it's your take on something, even if you're using the same trope. So it doesn't matter that somebody else wrote, you know, the Harry Potter people as Avengers. It doesn't matter that somebody else wrote, you know, something else that you're thinking of. Write your own story. That's the whole point. Have fun doing it, because this is really about having fun. We have been in fandom for 2 decades.
Yeah. I discovered it when I was about 13 in middle school and started with the X-Files. I don't know about you, Elle.
I started with Sailor Moon.
Mm-hmm.
And my fanfiction.net profile is old enough to drink.
Harry Potter Veggie Tales, you know what? That probably exists.
Write it.
I just saw it in the chat.
I believe in you. If it doesn't already exist, I think you should write Harry Potter Veggie Tales.
And chances are probably somebody already did.
And if somebody already did, more cake.
So fandom again has been around since at least modern fan. You can argue that fandom is, I don't know, all the way back to Sherlock Holmes, the way that people would, and it's probably even earlier. But modern fandom generally gets traced back to Star Trek and what happened with the fans there, where they started their own fanzines, which was actually printed out books that they would mail to each other. And then it went from there. And then they discovered the internet and it just kind of really took off from there, at least fan fiction did. And so,
and
of course,
fanzines still exist.
Yes.
You can get them in PDF. They still get mailed out. There are people who have entire libraries of them. Of even, you know, there's, it was just announced yesterday, a new Voltron one.
Yeah. And over time, we've developed just like any culture, we've developed our,
a lot of our own terminology.
This is kind of the stuff that hopefully that if you know this, you'll be able to start navigating right away.
Yes. And you won't get lost and go, what does this person mean? Because hopefully by the end of this panel, you'll be able to drop into a fandom Discord and go, hi, I'm new, but I'm not that new.
Oh, awesome. They have a fanzine collection at the San Antonio Public Library.
That's awesome.
Sweet.
I'm super jealous. My library doesn't have that.
But the common terminology, RPF, I don't know if you want to define that.
Sure. So RPF is real person fiction. So if you wanted to write a story and you wanted to write a story about two people that are real versus characters. So if you wanted to write a story about George Clooney and Sandra Bullock as real people instead of, I don't know, Tony Stark and Harry Potter, then that would be RPF, because then you are talking about, you know, real people. There are some archives and some fan sites that don't allow RPF, just because some people find it icky. You Do You, yeah, which is generally, we're going to get to the You Do You part. That's part of the how to find what you want. And, you know, it is actually not legally iffy. We'll get there. We're not talking about news. We're talking about stories.
Yeah.
So we're talking about like so-and-so, you know, decided to, you know, go to the coffee shop and play basketball and, you know, whatever. We're not talking about, you know, publishing it as this is a thing that really happened. We're talking about this is a story that I wrote for my own entertainment.
Yeah. The next one is AU, which stands for alternate universe. That can be any number of things. I've read some excellent alternate universes where the Avengers are, I don't know, in space and they're in a spaceship. Canon divergence is like when you decide, you know what, I don't like the way that that the TV show is going. I'm going to write my own ending, or I'm going to write my own. That kind of leaks into
this is especially
making coffee is the ever popular AU,
in Voltron,
yes,
fandom, because everyone hated season 8 and the last section of season 7. So most people will just pretend they never happened. Or like Game of Thrones, also season 8. Which, by the way, if you search AO3 for, you know, season 8 canon divergence, you will get the top two will be Voltron and Game of Thrones.
This actually leaks into Fix It Fic, which is another thing that we'll get into in the next slide. But, you know, so-and-so didn't die at the end of Endgame. Anyway.
No spoilers.
No spoilers. Self-insert is actually one of the most common ways people get into writing, if you think about it, is you put yourself in the story. So some people don't like reading them, but you know what? Write it. You do you.
It usually manifests as reader fic or like slash you or slash reader. Because at least on AO3, we differentiate between and slash. So if you're looking at, you know, a relationship and it says, you know.
Oh man, that's another thing we completely forgot to put in the PowerPoint. I just realized that.
And it says, you know.
It says, okay, Tony
Stark. Pepper Potts and Tony Stark. It means that they're friends. And if it says Pepper Potts slash Tony Stark, it means they're together.
And there's a whole history about the slash, which would take up the rest of this thing if we went into how the slash became that marker.
The slash.
Yeah. Crossovers are like the Avengers meet the people from DC. Or they visit the Harry Potter world and run into Harry Potter.
So a lot of people end up being confused about the difference between a crossover and a fusion. The difference is if you take the Avengers and Harry Potter and you cross them over so that the Avengers go to Hogwarts and they end up as teachers for the Harry Potter characters, that's a crossover. If you take the Avengers and stick them in the Harry Potter universe and S.H.I.E.L.D. ends up as the teachers and you are in the Harry Potter universe but have no Harry Potter characters, that's a fusion.
The next one, SHIP, that's short for relationship, which if you even want to get older into fandom history is short for relationshippers, which was related to Mulder and Scully in the X-Files fandom. That's another one we could spend all day talking about. But SHIP basically means what kind of relationship you like. Are you into Tony Stark, Harry Potter, or are you into Tony
if
Stark,
I'm
Pepper
like
Potts?
Kylo Ren and Rey, I ship it.
Exactly. Canon is
forever.
What is on the screen. Canon is what's on screen or what's in the book. Fanon is what you come up with in your head that makes sense. Like one of my fan-ins is that Tony Stark wears sunglasses all the time. Yes, some people have an entire fleet of ships, yes.
I have an entire armada.
One of my fan-ins, which kind of leads
into
head-canon.
That's a headcanon.
That's a headcanon, sorry. Okay, fan-in is stuff that like more than
the entire
fandom kind of picks up, or a section of the fandom picks up. Elle, if you would like to continue. Sorry.
So Fanon is, if the entire fandom says, you want to know what, this probably happened, or this is agreed upon. Like, again, Voltron, no one knows the last name of the bulk of the characters, but it's generally agreed upon that Keith's last name is Kogane, because that's the last name of the Red Paladin from one of the older shows. So do we know Keith's actual last name? No. Does the entire fandom agree that that's his last name? That's what we use? Yes.
Another example of that is the name for Tony Stark's bots. Like, we know that Dummy is one, and I think we know that You is one, but there was another one that fandom just completely agreed was named Butterfingers, but then turned out to just be a nickname Robert Downey Jr. gave one of the bots when he was filming. So fandom seized on that and decided the robot was named Butterfingers. That's a fanon too.
Canon accepted.
Yes. Headcanon is like your personal headcanon, like your personal canon, like what you think as a fan. Like one of mine is that Tony Stark always wears sunglasses because he's really readable through his eyes. So he always wears sunglasses so people can't see it. Really, I think it's just because RDJ likes sunglasses, but that's my headcanon to make the Tony Stark character make sense to me. Do you have one that you like?
One of my favorite characters in Star Wars is Alexander Kallus from Star Wars Rebels. And I have a headcanon that before joining the Empire, and then spoilery stuff happens that I'm not going to mention because everyone should watch Star Wars Rebels, that he was actually from Lower Coruscant and that his accent's fake.
So we have Fluff, which is just, you know what, I'm not in the mood.
Adorable, for
happiness. Adorable happiness, like, you know, Tony Stark and kittens, or, you know, any
sometimes
other character.
You just want to cuddle Baby Yoda and have happy things happen.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. That's Fluff. Anyone with kittens.
Anyone,
yes, Rhonda.
With kittens.
Feels are like, again, that's just kind of the funny way that fandom goes. Oh my God, this is I have all the feels about this particular thing. I don't know if it's just fandom. I think it might just be anyone with Baby Yoda, that too. Now, glitter
anyone
fandoms,
with Baby Yoda.
That's a fandom that gets everywhere. Like glitter. If you've ever done a project, a glitter project with a little kid, you know you'll be finding glitter in places you never even thought you could find glitter.
Pacific Rim is a glitter fandom. It was a one-off movie because the sequel never happened because it was criminally terrible, from 2013, which was a spectacular movie, which if you have not seen, you should fix that. And even now you will find, you know, Pacific Rim AUs or Pacific Rim Fusions that, you know, 7 or 8 years later, people are going, this was so interesting. This was such a cool concept. We're still doing it.
Yeah. And
from a one-off movie.
And that actually applies to, if we're talking about an earlier generation, there was this kind of crazy sci-fi series called Highlander, which had some good movies, some bad movies, and a couple of decent series in it. But that TV series gets everywhere, because everybody likes to like their people immortal. What else is another one?
The Sentinel was one.
The Sentinel
really
was one
time.
That got around.
And now most people know the trope, but don't actually know that the Sentinel existed, which is probably a good thing.
Yeah, it was a pretty
Dark
normal
materials,
procedures.
Daemon AUs are still a really big thing, even though
they've tried to make it, even though the
little questionable.
The source material, the books are good. Anyway, we'll move on. And crackfic.
Crackfic is delightful.
It's funny because let's see, I'm trying to think of crackfic, like a good crackfic. What's a good crackfic that you read lately? Just to explain it. It's an idea that's so crazy you thought that the person was on crack when they came up with the idea.
Crackfic is it is just meant to be ridiculous.
And sometimes crackfic taken seriously, that's another trope. and common terminology is actually a really good. That's like,
and it's really just meant to be fun. Like, it's truly, utterly ridiculous.
Try to think of what. Oh man, what's a good crack fic? Like one of the favorite crack fics I'm in, as you can tell, I'm kind of in the Avengers fandom right now, is for some reason people like turning Tony Stark into a cat. I don't know why, but then again, he would make a pretty good cat, wouldn't he? Yeah. So you'll just get all these random crack fics of Tony Stark being turned into a cat. Or basically, if you see something labeled crack fic, be prepared for Looney Tunes that you'll enjoy.
Yes, this is Looney Tunes level ridiculous. It can be absolutely anything.
Yes, all right. Fun tropes. I think we kind of mentioned some of these already. Coffee shop AU.
Now I want to look up crack fic on my favorites and see what kind of things I have.
Yeah. So like coffee shop AU is, for some reason, people really like writing their favorite characters, running a coffee shop or going to a coffee shop. It's become a thing.
Or being barista.
Or being a barista. High school AU, and I spelled high school wrong, sorry about that. People like to rewrite their characters in high school. My personal theory is that I think that's a lot because the people are in high school, so they like envisioning, again, that transformative work thing, putting yourself, being able to get something out of the media the way it is. Like, what would the Avengers be like in high school? What would the people from Star Wars be like in high school? Would, you know, Han Solo be a jock, or would he be a weirdo? You know, would Leia be one of those kids that was in every club on the planet?
She would be the head of the debate team. Thank you.
She would be the head of the debate team. Self-insert fic. We kind of mentioned that already. That's another one. The new boy spinoff is the superheroes in high school. De-aging. That's another one that for some reason is a lot, has caught a lot of traction. Like turning a character into a kid.
There's a super adorable one about Hawkeye turning into like age 9 that I love.
Oh. Body swap, which is, I mean, that's been done before. Like, I'm trying to think of, oh, what's that cartoon? I mean, Freaky Friday. That was a movie where the parent and the kid swaps bodies. And that's actually a really fun trope if it's done right. Harry Potter, again, we've got fusions, and some of the real, real common ones are Harry Potter, His Dark Materials, Marvel, Star Wars.
I found my favorite crack fic. Clint Barton runs for president.
Yeah, that one's actually really funny. Like something that makes absolutely no sense, but the way that the author wrote it, it's actually a really good fic.
And it's hysterically funny.
And then fix it fic, that's a lot of times, that tends to go around, that tends to be a thing like when a character dies or there's a big event or a breakup or a get together that fandom doesn't like. And so that ends up being a thing. Like,
pretend this didn't happen.
Let's just pretend this didn't happen and they're all happy living together.
There's a
else.
Thousand better ways this could have gone. Like, yes. Season 8 of Game of Thrones. If you had, you know, actually made it a 10 episode season, if you had put more functional things in, if you had actual character development, you know, write it out, make it functional.
Somebody
and then
in
there have been some really spectacular and then there have actually also been some really spectacular post-canon things, which is another you know, trope.
And what was I going to say? Oh, like there, sorry. That's also another thing about fanfic too, is that a lot of people use it and actually do it better than canon. Like one of my favorite icons I had from some that I didn't have it, but somebody that was in my fanfic circles had, it was canon error, apply fanfic. And it was in the style of like Windows 98 or Windows 95, like as in like an error that had popped up on your computer.
I need to find that. That's amazing.
Yeah, it was adorable. I don't know if I could find it again, but it was a great, but that's kind of what people end up doing, is if they don't like something canon, they write fanfic about it. So the thing is how do you get into it? How do you find your fandom community?
You can tell a lot of these photos came from my adventures in Star Wars conventions, by the way.
yeah. So this is obviously Bender from
Star Wars Celebration Orlando.
Yes. And R2-D2. And thank you, Futurama. Thank you. I had a brain fart. All I could think of was Matt Groening's thing that's not Simpsons. Futurama. And it's R2-D2 and Bender as two robots, two kind of cranky, pissed off robots, which actually is a really good mashup. Search your Twitter, Tumblr hashtags. Search your Twitter, Tumblr hashtags. Find a fandom Discord. Now that tends to be a little bit like you have to talk to a friend of a friend of a friend or get the link on a Discord. But
there are thousands of fandom Discords. There are multi-fandom Discords. There are single fandom Discords. There are single pairing Discords. And they are ridiculously fun.
Yeah, fandom is about community. Like a lot of people, myself included, got into fandom because particular issues in our life were difficult. And you know, it's middle school. I don't know. I know one person that had a good time in middle school. Nobody liked middle school. Found community through my fandom. What do your friends like to read? I have made
so many amazing friends, yes, through fandom. Paula being one of them, by the way.
We met online and happened to be in the same city is what happened.
Yes. And now we have a whole Chicago crew of us.
What do your fans like to read? Post-pandemic conventions, which are kind of get a crew together and go to a convention. That's where you find out who's doing what and who's and where. And online events like this one.
Texas, by the way, is supposed to have a spectacular renaissance there. And I am super jealous of you all.
Let's see. So there's also a few major sites. Archive of Our Own, which is what we work for. It's the best. A fan-created, fan-run, nonprofit, non-commercial archive for transformative fan works like fan fiction, fan art, fan videos, and podfic. That's kind of our ethos is basically, as long as it's not against our TOS, we host it, period. And it was created because fandom got tired of being kicked off of all their other spaces. So we got together and realized, wait a minute, you're a lawyer and you're a coder and you write for the newspaper. So wait a minute, we can do our own website. And what is it, 12 years later, something like that, we're still here. I think we started in 2008.
And there's no ads. We're entirely run on donations. And it's pretty great.
It is pretty great. Fanfiction.net was actually before that. But they have a little bit like, if you're a parent, yes, we even want a Hugo. If you're a parent and you're a little worried about like what your kid might be getting into, fanfiction.net is probably better to start with because they don't allow explicit fics as much. However, Archive of Our Own does make it so that you can filter that out pretty easily. Wattpad is another place. I haven't been in Wattpad, but I hear that's a really hot place for fanfic too as well.
Also not been on Wattpad, so I can't speak for their...
Speaking of donations, will AO3 get a Patreon? No, but we do allow people to...
Set up reoccurring donations,
which is pretty much the same as a Patreon at that point, except we don't do little extra things. Yes. One of the things you got to know about fanfic is there's this culture of... There's the tagging culture, which is we want people to enjoy our stories. We don't want people to be scared of them or get weirded out by it. So there's a culture of tagging everything. Like,
the culture is don't like, don't read. P.S. Yes. I made those cupcakes. Yes, they have more Oreos in the middle and they were super delicious. What we do is authors tag their stories and they tag based on three categories. They tag on character, relationship, and freeform. Freeform is also known as additional. So character additional tags are obviously, you know, Tony Stark is in this story, Clint Barton is in this story. And if you tag Hawkeye, then in tag regulars, our job is to say, okay, if
which
you
which Hawkeye did you mean?
Did you mean Hawkeye from MASH? Did you mean Hawkeye from Full Metal Alchemist? Did you mean Hawkeye?
And then Hawkeye from Last of the Mohicans?
Oh, okay. I didn't even think of that one. Figure out which Hawkeye and make sure that it ends up in the right place. And then, you know, you can search by character and you can just click on a character and all of the stories coming up with that character. If you just want to read about, again, Tony Stark and Pepper Potts, you can do that. Freeform are absolutely bonkers. There's everything from the aforementioned tropes that we were talking about, alternate universe, and then, you know, the individual types of alternate universe. And then there's things like, I'm bad at tagging, or no beta, we die like clones, which is the saddest tag ever, but has over 100 uses.
Or like one of my favorite tags is Howard Stark's A plus parenting.
Which is absolutely sarcastic.
Which is sarcastic because he is not a good parent. Both, it's not quite as blatant in the movies, but if you look at the comics, he is not a good parent. so it's fun. It's a fun tag because tags are both informational and a place to kind of express yourself a little bit.
And then when you're tagging a story, you can put things like tags that we call canonical, which are things that are official tags.
Yeah, this is a bit AO3 specific, but places do use tags besides
Sansa
just
Stark is the queen of the North, in which case you will find all things that are Sansa Stark and the queen of the North. And then you can write, you know, I wrote this at 3 a.m. when I was really tired.
Yeah. The other thing that's big is to filter out what you don't like. Don't like, don't read is very much a ethos in fandom because we're all about everybody being able to express themselves. So if it's not something you like, just let it go by.
If you know in advance that something makes you uncomfortable, it is your responsibility to say, hey, this makes me uncomfortable. I'm going to go to the exclusion filters and say, I don't want to read about self-harm. I don't want to read about, you know, something else. I don't want to read about alcohol. I don't want to read about anything else because that will make you uncomfortable or you're just not in the mood for it. Whatever the reason, like that's up to you. But it's your responsibility to know yourself well enough to say, hey, I'm going to filter that out because that's my experience.
Yeah. So we are at the end of the PowerPoint presentation part of this with this adorable little knitted Dalek.
Which, by the way, fancrafts totally count. You can knit a Dalek and post a picture of it on the archive.
People write... And we kind of skipped over some of the stuff that we were going to say about like all the different things that people do. They'll do like, hang on, let me get, cause I'm working with two different screens right now to make sure I have lots of moving parts right now. Okay, there we go. So it's like fan art, which we saw, fan vids, which people will they'll-
Someone matched up, I should say, the first 3.5 minutes of the Star Trek 2009 movie with Queens, The Show Must Go On. And it matched up perfectly. It was kind of eerie and kind of awesome.
There's something called Filk. I never can pronounce it not right. F-I-L-K, which is kind of fanish music, which people will rewrite songs to be fan songs, like the whole Taggerman, the whole, what was I going to say? That's not a right one. The whole Wellerman thing. Folk music. The whole perfect. Wellerman thing, like that spawned a Star Trek version. That spawned, what other versions did you see on TikTok? That was, I know I saw
there
the Star Trek version.
There have been Avatar The Last Airbender musicals on TikTok. There have been Harry Potter musicals on TikTok. There've been actually a ton of really cool musicals on TikTok that people have done that have been spectacular.
Let's see, there's Podfic, which is where people get permission from the person that wrote the fic, and we'll do like a audiobook version of it. So they call it podfic, like pod, like podcasting or such. So back in the days when we all had iPods. Some people will do fan recipes. Binging with Babish, who's actually a pretty big YouTuber, does it. He does fan recipes all the time, to the point that I think John Favreau from Chef discovered that he was doing fan recipes, and they did a whole thing. They made like little Mandalorian blue cookies, which is a bit of a spoiler, but you'll see.
By the way, the aioli pasta recipe from Chef is absolutely spectacular. Highly recommend the cookbook.
Fancraft, we saw the Doctor Who scarves.
There are endless ways to express yourself in fandom. Like, I know there's going to be a fandom during the pandemic panel later, which sounds absolutely spectacular, and I'm totally going.
So I think, Elle, we're at 11:47, at least according to my...
Which means it's time for questions.
And popping back in to help take some questions, but I'm going to start with one of my own.
Okay.
That's an awesome presentation. And one of the things that I'm taking away from it is, you know, you can just kind of do anything, you know, anything your mind can create. And in this day and age, with everything people have been dealing with, I'm guessing that has a very big therapeutic effect for people. Have you seen a lot more sort of fan fiction and stuff happening?
Yes.
The amount of usage on the archive has skyrocketed.
Yes.
I wish we had thought to put in the graph of usage, because honestly, like the amount of people who have been, you know, using the archive daily, and we've had so many people writing fics about quarantine and COVID.
Or not even about quarantine and COVID, just using it as their escape, because like they want to live in their world. Early pandemic, the only thing my brain would do is read fanfic. Yes, like
that's a whole mood that I totally understand.
Yes.
And like any of our guests, if you want to throw in any questions, feel free to jump in at any time.
Oh, that's awesome. I'm glad you started joining us.
Yeah, so we're biased because, you know, we volunteer enough of our time that it's like a part-time job for the archive, but...
Are most of the people that work for AO3 volunteers, or...?
Everyone is
a volunteer.
We do, for some of our difficult coding things, or like our coding team will decide like what they want, and then they send it out to, sometimes we'll pay for that for contractors. But other than that, our lawyers are volunteer, our writers are volunteer, all the coders are volunteer, except for the stuff that we ship out to somebody else. I'm trying to think of what else, like the tag wranglers, everybody's a volunteer.
So most of our budget, which is actually available fully online on our website, you can see goes to, because we own our own servers and own our own hardware, so that no one can say, hey, we don't like this, we're just going to destroy you, so that we're not on like Amazon web hosting or anything. Yeah. We're actually our own independent item.
Cool. And one of the things that I know you briefly mentioned it, but the site did win a Hugo, which...
Yes, we did.
That's pretty awesome.
Okay, here, let me see if I can share this real fast. This is from the AO3 status Twitter. Hold on, let me see if I can share screen. Okay, I don't have anything weird in this. Okay, there we go.
You'd be surprised how many fandoms are like, you
can
think
can everybody see this?
Oh, no, I still see Fuzzy Dollar.
Okay, hang on. I will get this working.
Surprised how many fandoms that you think are pretty dead. Like,
there we go.
One of my favorite fandoms is Gundam Wing, which was a anime from 1995.
So this was from the AO3 status Twitter. Let's see, April 24th. So robots. Those dots are basically our growth of like how many hits per week we're getting. And you'll notice right around the end of February into March, it's skyrocketed.
Yeah.
And it's pretty much been at that level ever since.
Wow.
Yeah.
Cool. Well,
yeah. So, I mean, we were at kind of a growth anyway. Like, if you'll notice, this was the biggest year of growth we had. But even after that,
I know you could probably talk about this for hours. But one thing that, and I think we had a question about it earlier a little bit about the sort of legalities of it. One thing that Hugo did was, I think, sort of help make people realize it's okay to do this. It legitimized it a lot.
One thing that was really a cool moment, I was not watching at the time, but, you know, that we were talking about later, was they went, you know, if you have stories on AO3, stand up. And so many people in the room stood up. Because, and even on Twitter, you'll see professional authors who are saying, of course I have an AO3 account.
Oh, it's, in fact, like you said, not just the writing, but all the versions of fan fiction are just everywhere, especially now.
Mm-hmm. Well, and one of our main founders is Naomi Novak, who is a professional author.
Mm-hmm. Well, I've read some fan fiction. I'm sure everybody else that's read, you know, I mean, don't get me wrong, I have some authors I like, but I've read fan fiction that just blows away.
Yeah.
Like the books you'll find, mm-hmm. you know, the just amazing stuff.
Trying to think of what else. I mean, it's been a important part of my life. I think it's been an important part of Elsinore's life as well.
Oh, absolutely. And especially, again, the friends I've made, the communities I've been a part of. I mean, I've got, you know, my Discord on the in the background right here, and I'm in 40 something Discords, and I'd say probably 35 of them are fandom related.
Yeah.
All of our attendees watching, if you write fan fiction, you don't have to say what, but just say, let us know, does anybody here write fan fiction?
Or read it. I'll be honest, I've tried writing and it just never quite works. So like, I'm a voracious reader.
Same here, I don't write because I'm not that mean, but.
And you don't have to write to have an account. You can be a reader and have an account.
Very good point.
Written in red and read. Wrote and read many years ago. Nice.
Cool. I'm just always fascinated by how many creative people there are and the things that people come up with that you think, I never thought of that, but man, what a great idea.
Right?
You know?
I'm reading one that's absolutely spectacular and updates like midnight-ish every Monday. That's a crossover between Full Metal Alchemist and Criminal Minds, and I have never watched a single episode of Criminal Minds, and I don't know why this is so compelling, but it is.
I've read a lot of Star Trek Voyager by someone who was as good as the books. Yeah. Oh, Eli, I love both FMA and Criminal Minds.
Oh, it's absolutely spectacular.
Author?
Author is Angel Celine, all one word.
Sorry, who is the author? I didn't hear that.
Angel Celine, all one word.
Okay, cool. Yeah. Probably one of the reasons they work is they're good ideas to start with, and then you take a talented writer and you can really create some fun stuff.
Yeah, and that's often what happens. Melissa said my fanfic writing has inspired my desire to publish my own novel. It does. It's if you're ever interested in becoming, I mean, that you don't have to. People write fanfic for their entire lives and just love writing fanfic. They never want to write an original novel, but some people do. They get the practice in how to structure a story without worrying about characters, without worrying about other things. And then because they basically use the fanfic as a training wheels, they then jump in and write their own stories, their own original work.
One of my favorite series is over 2 million words. And this person is like, I will never publish anything. And it is a spectacular, ridiculous time travel series about Batman. Huh? And cool. It's long.
And I know too, like, from a library point of view, shall we say, like, you know, you can find fan fiction. You can decide what you like you're saying, using the tags and everything, which is something that's sort of hard to do if you're just looking for a book to buy or something. Mm-hmm. So you can very easily find what you like. And generally speaking, it doesn't cost what it would do to go out and buy books and
yeah,
you know, go to movies or whatever. So it's a nice aspect of that as well.
Oh, I would say fan fiction has saved me thousands of dollars, which has enabled my fabric stash, which has allowed me to make more fandom quilts.
I forgot to put that in. Quilt. She has a picture of a gorgeous...
my Wonder Woman quilt?
Your Wonder Woman quilt, wow. Yeah.
You'll see this. You'll have to tweet it later and just hashtag Pop Madness 2021. Like, what year are we in?
Yeah.
So
that
we
can find it. Time is soup.
Time is soup because it's the pandemic.
Yep.
Big thanks to AO3 for allowing downloads. My e-reader is stuffed with fanfic. Yeah. I love our download Same feature. Here. I love our download feature. It's amazing.
Well, I'll call out right quick. If we have any last questions or anything that you would like to ask our two wonderful panelists while you're taping them out, we will have this up. You know, if you missed the beginning or know somebody else that couldn't make it today to watch, we will have this up on our YouTube channel. And we will put an email. So if you have any further questions or things that you don't want to ask in the chat, you can contact it's Organization for Transformative Works and ask them. And if you know if they can't answer, they can put you through to who does.
Angel Celine has like 4 or 5 Full Metal.
Yeah, it's a series. The last one is currently being updated, but the rest of them are all finished.
We're giving out fanfic, Rex. It's a fandom we know.
My bookmarks is prodigious.
Well, and sadly lately I haven't had as much time to read. I've had less time to read the more, which is a bit strange, you know, during the pandemic. But I'm a big Supernatural fan, and there's a lot of fan fiction. For that fandom, so it's a very big part of so many fandoms, you know.
Yes.
And Supernatural has so many specific tropes where, like, the car has its own personality, is its own tab.
Yeah. We know the person that takes, one of the people that takes care of the Supernatural fandom, and they're always creating, looking at the tags and trying to create new ideas that are coming from the fandom. And some of the stuff that they come up with is like, only Supernatural.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I guess every
I stopped at season 5.
Now you've got time to catch up. Mm-hmm. That's the thing.
Glitter fandom, yes. They're very absolutely. Much a glitter fandom. They get everywhere.
And I had not heard that before. I love that term. That is awesome.
Yeah. I dived headfirst into The Witcher. But I am also a humongous Star Wars nerd.
Yep. If you hadn't guessed by the giant baby Yoda in the back.
Yes.
It was my Hanukkah present from my little brother.
I'm a little more old school. I was young enough to remember watching it when it first came out. So I, you know, the first VHS I ever got was the original, you know, A New Hope Star Wars. And since mm-hmm. that's not the only things you could get, I've seen it like 9 million times. So
it is the Squishmallow baby Yoda.
That's awesome.
And
these days when you can't hug
yeah.
people, that's so perfect.
It is, in fact, larger than my dog.
Yeah, my very first fandom was X-Files, is like kind of around that same era, like when X-Files was airing.
Yes. Great. Awesome. Well, I just want to say thank you again so much for coming and doing this. I had such a great time hearing it.
Yeah, thank you.
Well. And we will have it up, like I said, on YouTube. And I may be sending a lot of questions your way. We'll put that email up. And I hope that you'll come back and do some stuff with us in the future.
Okay. Yeah.
I just want to say thank you to all our attendees as well. I know things have been a bit crazy lately, so thank you for joining us. And I hope
As Chicagoans, we have so much sympathy for you guys dealing with what, like, we know what happens when you get cold and you're not prepared for it, and it's not fun.
Yes. It's wishing you all power and water soon.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. Like, surviving the cold up here takes a certain knowledge that I know you guys just don't have, unfortunately. I'm sorry.
Well, we're learning, you know?
Yeah.
So, and like anything, you know, we've got our fan fiction to, you know, even when the power's yep. like right.
Yep, exactly.
It's all downloaded to e-readers.
There you go. There you go.
Thank you so much. It was great being here.
Thanks for having us.
Thank you so much, and we'll see you next time. Bye.
Bye.